In my conversation today, I want to talk a little bit about the role of GCC in this conversation that Jody was talking about, a little bit about our and my sense of the arts here at the college, but also here in the community, and love to hear from all of you about that perspective as well, and I think that's what will make this a rich dialogue. I am not an artist in any way, shape, or form. On the rare occasion, I will play harmonica in the car when nobody else is around. I have had the opportunity of some formal music training as a young person, so I don't come to this conversation as an artist, nor am I trained really as in any way an art connoisseur, running around understanding when I go to a museum everything I'm looking at and all of its depth and breadth of understanding. But I come to this conversation clearly as an educator, and an educator in a small rural environment. I believe that in essence, and I've forgotten who said this, that somebody said somewhere along the line that art is not an after dinner mint, it's part of the main course of our meal. And in many people have talked about the importance of the arts and culture in a community and for individuals. Our role in developing the artist and our role in exposing all of our students, faculty, staff, and community to the arts is a significant part of our mission. It's not an after dinner mint for our college. It is part of the core mission of our institution. One of the reasons that I love this particular art gallery, and that when you walk through the third floor of this wing, is that our students who are non-artists, those who don't study painting, or those who are not guitar, practicing guitar in the music room, or those who are not taking theater as a vocation, are exposed to the arts in ways that I think are an essential component of our mission. All of our students should get an understanding and appreciation for the important role that art plays and that culture plays in the development of the full human experience. And so I agree with that comment that it's not an after dinner mint, but rather the main art and culture and that experience is essential to the development of the full human experience. And part of our mission is driven by an understanding of what do our students need most from us. I am particularly concerned here in a small rural environment in times of great scarcity that the arts and culture, if they are perceived as after dinner mints and not part of the essence of a strong, vibrant community, that they begin to fall away from the experience available to all of our residents. I'm reminded of the way in which some of our schools struggle to keep art in the curriculum, art and music in the curriculum. I'm very well informed about how, you know, if the economy of scale is such, selling tickets and keeping it affordable, accessible to all, is a huge challenge in a small rural environment. And so it's easy to see how with in a time of scarce resources that fewer and fewer people become have the arts and culture available to them. That is, art and culture will fall away first in the small rural environments because of the economies of scale. This past Sunday, I was on a bus with a bunch of folks that went into Boston, and we took a little walk, a couple of us, and we went down to get a cup of coffee at a chain, a Starbucks chain. The numbers of people online to get into that one coffee place was huge. And so I was thinking about our coffee places and the comparison of how many coffees you have to sell here versus the coffee that this particular place, which, you know, there's a coffee place on every block in Boston, and every one of them has these long lines. And then we took a walk down to the Stuart Gardner Museum and saw the number of people walking around in this incredible place to view art. And I looked at the number of people paying $15 to get in to see beautiful art, including the pieces that have been stolen. It was a great tribute to that. And then I think about our community. So this college remains vigilant about our commitment to the arts because it's a contradiction to some of the things going on out there. And as a result, we can be part of the collaborative effort with people at Double Edge, with people in the public schools, with people in the Pioneer Valley Symphony. That is, it's important for all of us to be collaborative so that we can sustain art and culture in our community. That's the perspective I bring to this conversation. It is not one trained or educated specifically to that, so I'm no expert in that conversation. Lived out here in Western Mass for 17 years now, Berkshire County and here, and we know that art and culture is such a strong part of the base of our experience here. It is a strong part of the economic base. It's a very strong part of the cultural base. So I think building on our strengths in Franklin and Berkshire County, Western Mass, is an exciting and very optimistic perspective about what we're all doing together. With that, whoever wants to go next.
I think I do, but I have a disclaimer first that I'm not a rock star. So. He might be a rock star here. So I want to introduce Double Edge just very briefly because I think a lot of you probably don't even know who we are. We just celebrated in April our 30th anniversary, and we started in Boston in 1982, and we moved to Western Mass and Ashfield in 1994, thinking that we were going to just have a rehearsal space and a space where we could afford to live and keep our Boston space for performances because we didn't associate this part of the world with any kind of possibility for performances. But it was really, really affordable for us, or more affordable than Boston, let's say. So within 3 years, in 1997, everything turned around. We gave up our Boston space. We opened our first theater venue on our farm in Ashfield, and the rest is history. But this history includes right now two performance spaces and probably we'll have a third one by the end of next year. Two properties that Double Edge owns and a long-term, let's say, we have been given a property for artist housing by some local people. We have space for gallery, we have cooking spaces, we have a full-time student program that runs almost all year round, and we have our community project, which is what Bob was talking about. We call it an indoor-outdoor traveling spectacle, which is the audience travels around with us through the buildings, through the pastures, almost into the pond, and maybe at some point will travel up the hills with us, but not now. So almost all of this happened because of the community. So I would have to strenuously disagree that the lines in Boston demonstrate more of a commitment to art than our, you know, lack of lines or lack of money even, because after 20 years in Boston, I found a pretty isolated and alienated experience that was immediately not true in Ashfield, which is a town of 1,200 people. So while there's clearly a different economic structure in our part of the world, there is it's really made up for by the commitment of the community and the larger community in wanting to be involved in everything, both for good and for bad. So I think that the discussion needs to be about how to allow that community to be engaged with what we do and how to see that community rather than talk about that community or make things about that community or say what they want. When we first came, we were guilty of this. We were very idealistic and thought that nobody would bother us and we could do whatever we wanted in Ashfield, as opposed to in Boston, where we had to put up fire alarms and all these other things, and they were in the way of what we were doing. We found the opposite was true. Everybody pays attention to every single thing you're doing, including the fact that they wondered why, if we were a theater, we weren't performing. So therefore, we must be a cult. So we really quickly changed our mind and were like, we better perform, because we do want to be engaged. We don't want to be isolated like we were in Boston. So now, we had a large audience in Boston. We had as many people as we wanted to have in Boston. We were a touring theater. We're still a touring theater. But we weren't engaged. And there's a big difference between an audience and a community. Here, we have a community. They work with us. They, practically speaking, designed the summer performance that we did. Local artists made the mosaics for the performance. People made sails out of wool. People dug up and put concrete in where we needed to fly safely instead of our way of doing it, which might not be called safe. This is a real community engagement project. It took about 10 years to get there. To me, Double Edge is like a local organic farm. We have some seeds that we knew we wanted to plant. But we needed a huge amount of help with the farming of those seeds. And in my opinion, art has to be local. It can't be not like that, whether it's in a rural area or a city. It has to be part of the community. Otherwise, it's not alive. It's a reproduction of something. So that is what this community taught us, and we have now tried to engage schools, and including GCC, but also we're working with Four Rivers, we work with Heath Elementary School, we work with, well, Matthew will go into that, I'm sure, but because if you really want to plant seeds, you have to start with young people. Carlos?
Do you want to say something? I know you do.
Yes. That was very good. I do want to clarify that when I was talking about the economies of scale, it wasn't that there was more support in Boston than locally, but that the total number, and in fact the percentage engaged in the arts out here might be more, but the total number of people who engage with the arts, percentage-wise might be larger, but numbers-wise might be smaller. And so the challenge to small rural environments is greater. And I do think you are absolutely right that one of the ways to meet that challenge is to be far more engaged and can create sustainable models that are based on collaborative and sustainable integration. And so I really do agree with that, but I probably was not clear enough earlier.
I was just trying to give you a hard time. That's my job.
Thank you very much.
I think it's interesting, and I'm going to try to grab on to this to maybe propose and open up the conversation, because I do think we're talking about human activities. So culture is human activities. So the fact that there are, even when I arrived to the US, in the main cities I couldn't get an espresso. 1996, 1994, 93, not to mention here. So when I first came here in 96, there was no espresso. I'm coming from Buenos Aires, where we praise ourselves for having Viennese coffee shops and, you know, people playing classic music and all that stuff. And what happens, I think, with a coffee shop is that if we look in detail and if we pay attention to that, is telling us that people are not just getting together in bars, which is a change of activity. So that's what I'm talking about, activity. You know what I mean? So we do activities, all of us, like we either choose to do farming or we build military weaponry and, you know, we go out and kill everybody, or we stay inside and we do crochet. And this, all these are human activities. What culture, somehow when we talk about, what are we talking about when we're talking about culture? When we're talking about culture, we're talking about us meeting each other and starting to find some form of dialogue. So, and I want to thank you for this opportunity, because a lot of times we outturn dialogues into soliloquies. So we talk to somebody else, but we remain in that conversation. So when you make something public, you are somehow committing to what you're saying. I mean, I cannot backtrack if now I say I want to work with GCC, but then, you know, tomorrow I'm going back home and say, I'm not doing it. So what happens when we invest in activity, I think, this is my observation, when I am committing to my own activity, I'm taking a leap of faith and I'm trying to kind of like develop some kind of trust with somebody else. If I'm going to come and train with you, I need to come and train with you. I cannot not, you know, really sore today. I'm not doing it. But so I'm committing to that. And this is in... deep down, and I'm not going to go all the way there, but deep down, this is what engines an economy. You know, it's not an accident that somebody put in the dollar bill, "In God We Trust." I mean, there needs to be trust. And for any economic or cultural activity, and that's what art teaches. Art teaches about faith, and art teaches about trust, the same as religion, but in a different way. And it does a teaching without proselytizing. It's a teaching that is not a dogmatic teaching. So in that, but there is a very important educational component in having art. And I think, you know, I was jotting down things in my mind when Bob was talking, And I was thinking, you know, it's not an accident that when societies like Greece or Spain get to the golden ages, they're at their peak of their expansion. And people think it's because, you know, they have all this money, they can invest in culture. And I think it's the other way around. I think that culture promoted that. Because, the Jewry of Spain, plus the Muslims of Spain, plus the Celts, plus all those tribes together, when they were together, brought up the Golden Age. Unfortunately, by that time, a group decided to kill everybody else, and that's what happened. But then Spain went the way that it went until nowadays. And you can see where they are. Greece, the same. You know, Pericles, how do you pronounce that? I don't know. But the king, you know, at his time, they got the Greeks, together with all these other cultures, got Greece into that moment. And then they couldn't repeat it again because there is a dysfunction. It's like a family. So when I came, you know, I was raised in a time of war in my country, and I devoted myself not only to art but also to movements, to see how can we develop movements that will enable and empower ourselves or those that we feel marginalized somehow, and we are marginalized or we marginalize ourselves, how to do something together to get out of that hole. So that, you know, I've been working on my whole life. And I do think that there are, I don't want to go into the obvious, I think GCC is a very important institution, and it's more and more important as we go, and for those reasons of, you know, the scale and the economy, but also the culture. I do think that Double Edge and a lot of other institutions in the area, all of them are fundamental, not just they're fundamental to the life. And I think that the partnerships are what can secure the sustainability of these endeavors. Now, in order for those partnerships, and this is where I'm going to put the question out there, I think that the problem for the partnerships to happen, like with any activity, again, is a problem of mindset. We all develop our institutions in such a way, and then we think that we need to do the business as we know, and in reality, what needs to happen is that we need to change the business that we know in order for us to promote or to continue to grow. And in order, I think that in order for for institutions like GCC and Double Edge and maybe others to get together and work, one of the major challenges is for us to really rethink our mindset. How can we work together? Because if we don't put in time, and it's not money, it's time, to sit down in a coffee shop and drink that coffee that is going to help us come up with the ideas, come up with the questions that we have. If we don't do that, you know, 1 year goes on and on, and we're busy. We're really busy, all of us, and successfully so. So we're not going to change that. And I think that not changing that is, it's a little bit of a loss, of a liability, not just for us, but also for the societies that we serve, or that we also are nurtured by, from, because we not just serve, we get, as Stacy said, you know, a community nurtured us. So that's kind of like the question that I was having. How do we change our mindsets? How can we get together and go to a coffee shop and give them some business?
I've been elected to start off with a little bit of a question. And so this is from Lucy Lepard, who wrote The Lure of the Local Senses of Place in a Multi-Censored Society. And she writes, if labor is the mediator between nature and culture, as Marx says in Capital, landscape as the product of labor is a synthesis. It's resting somewhere between the two, as countryside forms the buffer zone between civilization and wilderness. So what she's saying is that there's nature, which is the wild, and there's culture, which is the city, the urban. And then where those two come together, there's something called landscape. And this is not nature in the wildest sense, and it's not the most urban sense of culture, but it's this intersection. And so I'm curious for our panelists to talk about, when we think about landscape as the product of nature and culture, and this is this sort of zone where we live in this rural area, we talk about Ashfield and Greenfield and Franklin County, how do we imagine this landscape evolving in this next generation? And so Lepard asks us to think of Marx, Marx asks us to think of industry as the shaper of landscape, but she also hearkens us to culture, and in the context that we've been talking about, culture has become the interface that we have with the environment. So I'm curious about, in your dreams, in your visions, how do we find that intersection? What are we going to see different for our kids when our kids are sitting in our seats talking about theater and literature and science?
My question was very similar, so can I just stick part of mine on Leo's, which is that it was really totally probably the same question, but I guess I need to say something. Which is, if I was thinking, and it's totally in line with this, if you look 5 to 10 years ahead, and you start from 50,000 feet, and you see New England, right, or whatever that is, and then you come down, and then you see Greenfield, and then all Franklin County, and then you see Greenfield and the hill towns, and you know, then you get closer, you see Double Edge and GCC, and all the artists, and then you see GCC. What's the activity you see happen that relates to this desire or your vision of evolution? If you take out time and money as obstacles now in our mindset, what would be some, what's in the dream?
I like that, the next evolution of humanity.
Well, I'm thinking about what you see here on the campus. What do you see out in the streets? What's in the minds of the, obviously the next generation is on our mind and is the most important thing, and you have incubation and training happening here, and you have a really specific, this is a local place. What are the human activities happening that aren't happening now?
Well, for me, the place I want to respond to is connecting the end of your question, Leo, to where you got to, and that is access and introduction of the arts to kids. You had mentioned it earlier that that future will be shaped by the degree in which those children, all of our children, will have access to an appreciation of the arts as part of a full life and a rich life, and not ancillary to it. And so the more we believe that, and the more we reduce access for kids to the arts, then the outcome of that inevitably is a redefining of culture, of life itself. And so that definition being shaped a generation from now, through the minds and the eyes and the senses of kids who are not exposed to the arts, I think will be darker. I think it would be less integrative and less sustainable. And I think access is connected to sustainability, that the arts and culture cannot sustain if it's not introduced to the young, if it's not part of an experience in education, pre-K through higher education, if it's seen only for majors and only for the few who, here at GCC, when a student walks through the art gallery and walks past the music rooms, they're being exposed. Our rock stars are our faculty, and so they're connect and staff, and they're connected to the primary mission of educating our students. We have future artisans who are majoring in the arts, some of which will you know, work and make a living at the arts. Some will switch majors and transfer off, and who knows where they'll go. But so primary to the art department is that a certain number of students will become majors, or a certain number of students in music will become majors. Second, and as important to us, is the exposure of all of our students, the non-major, that future nurse, the future accountant, the future teacher, and their exposure to the arts is critical to that sustainability and integration. How can you be involved in an integrative model if you're not exposed to it? How can you speak to the richness if you are not exposed to it? So primary is to have those students learn how to do the art and craft of art making. There's the secondary great experience for all of our students. Third is the way we open up our doors to the community. I think it was yesterday or the day before, a collaborative with one of the local high schools and one of our programs, and they put art upstairs in the community room based upon Holocaust readings. So opening the doors to the community, to the arts, is yet another part of our function and mission. And then it is this collaboration. It's this conversation. When Leo and others help convene the meeting and people come together, it's part of that sustainability. So I think access and sustainability is essential to sustainability, and sustainability is based upon integration.
I think that everyone is creative and has the potential to be creative and should from the day they're born till the day they die have the possibility to be creative. And as a specialized society, we tend to compartmentalize that now, and so we've become a workshop culture, kind of like, or a kid-centric culture. To me, creativity comes from a holism that I think is important to, I think is essential to adapt. So for me, rather than, I don't want to totally say the kids are the future. I mean, they're the future of, you know, 20 or 30 years, but somebody who's 80 is also the future. And the most rewarding experiences that I have in this regard are when all the generations are together and learning from each other or creating together, creativity needs to be acknowledged as something that we human beings have and own, and is not our right but our responsibility. Because if we aren't creative as a whole society, then we are the opposite, destructive as a whole society. That's not just war, that's the environment, or even just thought. So, in order to engage the youth, the non-youth has to be engaged. And also, in order to engage the youth, we have to understand that we each have a different role in that engagement. And the role of a spectator is equally, if not more important than the role of the artist. Training spectators, who, that's not a good word, because that puts a line between that person So let's call it participant in a creative experience, but not somebody who has to climb up on the silks or jump in the pond. So that is where we fail miserably at training, because there are tons of training programs and workshops and opportunities like that, and they would generally be much more full than an art exhibition or a even a discussion. So that needs to happen when it's much easier for us to engage a school in getting together a workshop. Oh, we're going to do a workshop, than it is in getting together, why don't you come to the performance? We had this interesting experience with the Odyssey, which is one of the textbooks, required textbooks in almost every 10th grade, every place, but particularly in the county, but getting those students to come to see the Odyssey was almost impossible. And it's not that we, well, we definitely need audience because that's who we are, but the idea is about engagement of young people and seeing that it doesn't need to just be a book, it's a creative experience when they read that. So my dream is that actually people will take their responsibility seriously at every age of not saying, I don't have time to go. Of course you have time to go. You just have priorities that are messed up. Because if you are not really fighting for creativity for yourself, then you are not sharing that as an example of what the young people can do. So, and in our case, there's not a financial consideration because you will be able to go if you can't afford it. But we can also help with that. I mean, we as a society can help with that by making programming for attendance. For museum attendance. There's plenty of museums in this area too. There's a lot of things. So we need to engage people, but the society needs to engage people.
I would like to extend that question. It sort of based on something you said really early on, Stacy, when you're talking about getting past this idea of talking about our community as if it is this other that we serve, that we somehow know how to serve best, you know, and can impart art and wisdom to. I mean, and engaging, and I mean, engaging keeps coming up, and that's true, but finding a different phrasing for that might help. Participation is a good one. I think for me, as an adjunct here, I think I have had the luxury of being able to spend an inordinate amount of time just focusing on my students, which I think is harder if you're full-time. Like, I really, that's all I do here is just talk to students a lot. And I think that it's a metaphor for us here, too. I mean, we're at our best at this college when we are not only talking about serving the needs of our students and handing over to them on a buffet what it is that we think is good for them, but really creating a dialogue with them. And my students crave that. And the cool thing is my students crave that from all different disciplines, in my writing classes and in my performance classes. There's this great, because it's GCC, like this great, amazing, diverse collection of old people and young people and people from sciences and nursing students and stuff that do think they're creative, and they are creative, and they don't have, which for me is shocking, because you don't do that, and they want to participate more than they want to be served, I think. And then again, I'm just speaking for them, which is kind of lame. But I do think that that's an important change. Like what Carl was talking about, we're really sort of changing the paradigm of how we approach audience relations and student-teacher relations, and you know, is to consider it that we're all community members. That we're all community members, and we all sort of ask the same questions. We all sort of have the same needs that are human needs. But how to best make those connections academically and artistically, you know, is what's interesting to me. One question I was going to ask, and you guys kind of touched on this already, and it's open to anybody here as well, is one thing that I'm curious about is how we all define sustainability in this context, like how that word that keeps coming up over and over, and how we can really consider sustainability in the arts practically from here and out, you know.
Our way of dealing with the issue of sustainability is a little bit different, and we are an arts place, and we are a center. So therefore, we have an agricultural component. We have a farm. We are trying to develop that into something that sustains us and ultimately will contribute to others. We have a center, an international center, so we bring a lot of people, students and artists in, and therefore those people need to live and eat in our community, and so there's a big financial exchange between us and our community. So there's a lot of things going on. We use almost entirely local labor, so we are part of where we live. We are not just giving whatever we produce, but we are producing with our community at this point. So we could say that they're artists in the project, but they prefer not to be, you know, labeled as artists. So I think there's a huge model there that some things could be extracted and used in other places, but the main thing that needs to be used everywhere is just exchange. Whatever it is, we live in a farming community, a former farming community, and now again a farming community. And so that's one of the roots of our exchange, but it could be anything, whatever I think is local to the people. The most creative project, or let's say a big turning point for us, was the building of our septic system. Our septic system was built by somebody who had been working with us for many years and, you know, ran away as soon as he finished working. And now he's an advisor of ours because it was such a powerful exchange. The building of it, the location of it, which was very important to us because of our performance, the ultimate fact that it became a platform for our performance because it's raised, so it's kind of like an opposite type of amphitheater. The participation required between us and them. And also, it's the only concrete thing on the farm, so it has a place where we can hold our rigging of our high-flying acts. So I don't think we can close our minds to the possibilities of what exchange is, especially when we're talking about sustainability, because sustainability will only come from honesty.
The only thing I would add, not the only thing, one of the things that I really want to say here is that this community gets it like few others in terms of the words sustainability and collaboration. That the model that this community is so comfortable with and has been developing over the last couple hundred years and has really gotten to a very good point is the model that should be emulated. And what I mean by that is when the international big banks began to implode, it's our small local bank, community-based bank, that stood up tall and actually strengthened our community. And the same is true of food production, community-based food production, community and alternative energy systems, healthcare, education, and arts and culture integrated is the sustainable model because of the way that collaborations and engagement and integration are essential to that survival. And I think this community gets it. Whether it's the Berkshires or Boston or New York or anywhere in the world, I think this community understands and gets that collaboration integration in ways that define sustainability as a result as much as it is the goal.
When I think about sustainability, I think about the possibility for a community or a group of people or a society to be dynamic and adjust to the changes, which not just economic changes, but life changes that entails to me ways to approach a government, like whether it's preferable in my case democracy, but democracy can be understood in many different ways, and it is, and to be flexible about it and to be flexible about participation, I think is a crucial component to sustainability. As probably we know, I'm not that versed in economy, although I love it, but monocultures are normally economy models that tend to disappear or to impoverish the people that practice that. So I think that in the 80s, as much as I hated the changes in the economy, in the world economy, that were led from within this country, some of them, there was something very important that, the notion of that diversified portfolio came into play, particularly to societies like not Western societies, but which to me means that you need to have a variety of responses within the same community, and I think that this is something you can observe in this community here in the West County, that there is that possibility. There is the craftsman, there is the agricultural that shifts like from the big dairy farms 25 years ago, now we going into this boutique type of farming where there is a very specialized organic product that can be sold, and these people find those markets or those niches where they can. I think that art brings also that kind of training. But I want to tie in a couple more things. One is something that I was thinking about what you were saying about bringing art. I agree with you, but on the other hand, I need to deal with a paradox. Because in my group, in my community, if I look at my neighbor that lives across the street, I am the one that decides to go deep into something that it could be, if it goes wrong, I could end up being crazy, right? It's like the journey of a mystic, except that I do it specialized in theater because that's what I love, and I go there. So when I come back and I meet him, I need to realize that I agree with you. I need to think, I cannot just bring this because they are not going to understand. But I can be a facilitator for some kind of experience. Yeah, Herbert Read, which was an incredible art thinker in England, said in 1940, I think, that an artist is not a special human being, that human beings are special artists, all of them. So, and I think that is a good idea just to workaround. But what I want to say about that is that I think it's important for the person that wants to undertake the journey, the difficult journey and dangerous journey of going deep into the art. That's necessary. Because otherwise you run the risk of watering down what you are bringing back to the people. And the people that don't want to take that, that is also good and it's important because everybody can do something. And I think that there is a key component of sustainability in that tension, but in not avoiding the tension.
Sharing of the tension.
Right. Passing it around.
Because the isolation, it creates contradiction instead of duality between both sides. There's this thinker who writes a lot about local agriculture who says like the tragedy of the modern economy is that it's successfully separated us from one another. And the most important thing to rebuilding that is to rebuild the fabric, the community fabric. And the first step to do that is for each participant in that to be healthier and happier in some way. And that comes from being together. So if there is always if there's always the same framework of the artist has to come to us and the audience has to always come to us, then we're just perpetuating
the divorce.
The divorce.
Yeah.
And in some ways, I think this is a good starting place, but I think it's important that we also, you talk about practicalities in your introduction, we should make a commitment to how do we practically address the sharedness, not sharedness, just sharedness. What are the intersections? Because it has to be, sustainability is just derived from an ecosystem. So if it is an ecosystem that we are designing, there has to be a design portion and there has to be an implementation portion. And that has to be done with rigor and commitment. Otherwise, all our self-consciousness of our community being progressive in a way can just as easily become stagnant. And then any stagnant resources is a waste of resources.
So I'll jump on yours since you jumped on mine. And we're one of my mentors, Julie Graham, defined an economy as, you know, thinking about it much more broadly and thinking about it as any system that moves to improve the quality of life. It's not about money, it's about improving quality of life.
Totally.
And if we think about economy that way, all different kinds of things are possible.
Yeah.
You don't have to think about what's the most practical job I can get. You're thinking more about what's the most enthralling, energizing, amazing thing I can do with my life?
Brilliant.
And do for other people around me. And then that totally changes the equation of economy. And Wendell Berry, one of our writers, says, the ecological crisis as a crisis of character, that is of culture. Our culture and place are images of each other and inseparable from each other. And so neither can be better than the other. What Wendell Berry is saying is if we don't fix our culture, we can't fix our environment. If we don't fix our environment, we can't fix our culture.
Right.
They're entwined. They're one and the same.
I just want to end, because I know we have to go, by thanking you. I really do think our means are the ends in the making. How we do stuff, what we do, define who we are. And this is the sustainable. This is the conversation that is a goal for sustainability. By making this happen, we're engaged in the process of the desired outcome.
Thank you very much. Thanks to the Rockstar panelists.